Napoleon Bonaparte, born on the small island of Corsica, is one of the most famous men to have ever lived, hailed as the man of the 19th century. Even his very name is used as a word to describe something momentous, colossal, Napoleonic. A rags-to-riches story, Napoleon was only 24 years old when he became a general, and 35 when he crowned himself Emperor of the French. Charismatic leader of men, shrewd politician, and a military genius, Napoleon fought 60 battles in his career and only lost 7 of them, making him the most victorious general in history. Not since the days of ancient Rome and the Caesars had one man conquered so much of Europe, or held so much power. As a ruler of France and its empire for nearly 15 years, Napoleon was also a reformer and improver. He played a leading role in solidifying the gains and ideals of the French Revolution, promoting equality and careers open to talent, securing religious freedom and tolerance, ending aristocratic and feudal privilege, and founding the Civil Code, a unified and progressive code of laws, which are still in use across Europe to this day. Napoleon's empire helped provide the basis of what is today the European Union. For this reason, Napoleon is often considered the father of modern Europe, and ever since him, the world was never really the same. To this day, Napoleon remains one of the most written about men in history, second only to Jesus Christ. Inspiring masterpieces of music, art, literature, and poetry, from Beethoven's stirring Third Symphony to Tolstoy's War and Peace, few fictional characters have ever done as much as Napoleon Bonaparte. The so-called man of destiny and a mass of contradictions, Napoleon is still something of an enigma, both a hopeless romantic idealist and the bitterest of cynics. The combination of his irresistible charm when he chose to deploy it, his iron will, workaholic habits, inspirational speeches and sayings, sheer intellect, and of course his fiery temperament, captivated or alarmed. To some he was a god, to others the Antichrist. And his meteoric rise and then crushing downfall has been compared to a Greek tragedy. After less than 15 years in power, in the last of 7 wars formed against him by coalitions of European monarchs, Napoleon was finally defeated at the Battle of Waterloo and exiled to the remote rocky island of St. Helena in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. At the end of his life, reflecting on his misfortunes, Napoleon's analysis was, "I have too much ambition and a spirit of fire." This is the story of Napoleon and the dawn of a new age. The rise of an obscure Corsican boy to the very pinnacle of fame and fortune, from soldier to statesman to emperor, has spellbound generation after generation. In an era where men and women tended to view each other as an occasion for physical pleasure or financial gain, Napoleon's family, the Bonapartes, believed in love, and were all, to a greater or lesser degree, passionate lovers. Napoleon loved to distraction, madly, unreasonably, obsessively, and his name is inextricably linked with his greatest love, Rose de Beauharnais, later nicknamed Josephine. Although she was a widow, 6 years older than him, with 2 children, Napoleon was smitten by this glamorous femme fatale. Josephine soon had the young general eating out of her palm. His obsession, muse, and lucky charm, Josephine would help him to rise to the great heights he attained, while her social tact and insouciance served as an excellent foil for Napoleon's boldness and energy. Like most great love stories, their relationship was a tragic drama of misunderstandings and poor timing. In the end, his love for Josephine and unwillingness to give her up would contribute to the downfall of his empire. Like so much about Napoleon, the story of how he first met her has been mythologized. After the 13th Vendémiaire, a law was passed forbidding any private citizen to have any weapons in his house. The 14-year-old Eugène de Beauharnais couldn't bear the thought of surrendering the sword that had once belonged to his guillotined father, and hurried off to see General Bonaparte. Eugène told Napoleon that he would rather kill himself than give up the sword. Touched by the young boy's emotion, Napoleon granted his request. The boy's mother, Rose de Beauharnais, in appreciation of his generosity, asked to meet the young general, but other accounts go that Napoleon was first introduced to Rose at one of Barras's parties. Either way, when Napoleon and Rose first met, it was unsurprisingly an unequal contest. Bonaparte may have been the genius on the battlefield, but in the drawing room it was Rose who was the prodigy. She combined physical allure with sweetness of character. Her features were pretty and angelic, as opposed to breathtakingly beautiful, but as Napoleon put it, she had a certain something that was irresistible. Rose was petite, and just 5 feet tall, the average height for a woman at the time, with chestnut brown hair, soft hazel eyes, small bowed lips, and a retroussé nose. She had all the dainty features that Napoleon was predisposed to like, and she had a gentle, very feminine nature. She was, he once said, all lace, and a woman to her very fingertips. Although Napoleon had settled effortlessly into his new post, his sudden social advancement was more difficult. Thrust into high society, he was a newcomer, an outsider watching from the sidelines, still unsure and a little out of place. Whereas Rose was resplendent. She belonged at the very core of the action, courted, endlessly pursued, popular, charming, at ease. She would have represented everything he wanted to be and everything he wanted to have. She was an accomplished sophisticate and seductress who had mastered all the skills necessary to ensnare and persuade. The perfection of her gestures, the creole elegance of her movements, and the soft depths of her voice entranced others. Rose seemed to know exactly when to bestow her enigmatic closed-mouthed smile or gently touch her companion's arm. She had the ability to listen so that the recipient felt they were at the very center of her world. In her hands, a fan was a deadly weapon. So when Napoleon actually had a conversation with Rose, it was no surprise that he was instantly lost. I was not insensible to a woman's charms, but until then I had hardly been spoiled by them, and my character rendered me shy before them. Josephine was the first to give me any degree of confidence. One day, when I found myself placed next to her, she said flattering things about my military talents. Her praise intoxicated me. I addressed myself only to her and never left her side. I was passionately in love with her, and our friends were aware of this long before I ever dared to say a word about it. Napoleon did not care for the name Rose, as was his habit with romantic interests. He gave her a nickname, lengthening and softening one of her middle names, Joseph, into Josephine. And it was by this name that he began to call her. In many ways, Napoleon and Josephine seemed like complete opposites, the extreme contrast of the masculine and the feminine. Yet, underneath, the Corsican and the Creole shared much in common. For a start, they were both born outsiders. Napoleon's great love led an eventful life even before they met. Like Napoleon, she was an islander. Their homelands were both pawns in the colonial games of Europe. Martinique, the island of Rose's birth, was one of the most strategically placed and valuable sugar islands in the Caribbean. The island was continually being passed backwards and forwards between Britain and France in their endless wars for economic and tactical supremacy in the Caribbean. Just like Napoleon, Rose was born French rather than an English subject by a stroke of luck. Her family, the Tachères of Martinique, was also noble, and they lived simply close to nature, and in doing so had retained the old virtues of nobility. Even so, the Tachères were better off and led a far easier life than the Bonapartes. Martinique was as lush as Corsica was rugged. Rose's family's plantation land stretched as far as the eye could see. The Tachère family ruled as absolute monarchs of all they surveyed, and little Rose was brought up with all the privileges befitting an heiress, raised amongst slaves who were exclusively occupied with fulfilling her every desire. Rose was typical of many Creole children, and by her own admission, it was a spoiled childhood. Despite this, Rose managed to remain sweet-natured, and neighbors called her the pretty Creole. Like Napoleon, Rose had a happy childhood. As an adult, Rose would recollect, "I ran, I jumped, I danced, from morning to night. No one restrained the wild movements of my childhood." Also like Napoleon, Rose had a strong mother and a weak, disorganized father. who was often absent at the family's other plantation or amusing himself in the capital. Under him, their plantation diminished to almost half the size it had been during its prime, and Rose's mother was left to pick up the pieces. Europeans living on the island were called Creoles, and they were seen as coarse, clannish, impatient, and according to one observer, violently attached to their pleasures. Their leisurely, affluent lifestyle fueled a tendency to ostentation and supported their lavish hospitality. But on the flip side, indulged from their infancy, growing up with a battery of slaves to perform the simplest tasks, Creoles were also seen as indolent and had little ambition. Later in life, Rose would exploit these ideas about Creoles to her advantage, taking refuge in her supposed native indolence to avoid doing things that she did not want to do. But Rose was, in many ways, an exemplary Creole, vivacious, pleasure-loving, sensual, and willful. The easy life of the islands put little emphasis on intellectual pursuits. Plantation owners had one preoccupation, to make money, and then to return to France. Not a single book, not even a newspaper, was published there, and the Creoles were said to have a repugnance for learning. Rose, too, was completely uninterested in academic matters. Her mother once declared, "Beautiful and good child, your character and your heart are excellent, but your head, oh your head." At the age of 10, Rose was sent to the capital of the island, Fort Royal, to be educated at a finishing school, and she learned how to dance, sing and play the piano, how to use a fan, and conduct a polite conversation. Few women of her time could have expected to have learnt much more. One officer serving in Martinique, Comte Montgaillard, met the 14-year-old Rose. She was, he remembered, suffused with grace, more seductive than beautiful, but already remarkable for the suppleness and elegance of her bearing, dancing like a fairy, amorous as a dove, and possessing a thoughtlessness, a coquettishness, which we no longer see, but which have astonishingly remained unchanged in the colonies, a certain capriciousness and extravagance, even though in real life the family lives in mediocrity. Martinique was always intended as a place Rose was meant to leave. Throughout her childhood, the prospect of going to France was dangled before Rose, always tantalizingly beyond her reach. At around this time, Rose and two friends went to see the local sorceress. The old woman told Rose that her palm revealed two marriages. The first would be to a young fair-haired man connected to her family. He would take her to Europe, but the marriage would not be happy. After many tribulations, she would remarry, and this second marriage would be to a dark-haired man of little fortune. But he would become famous, covering the world with glory, and making her greater than a queen. But, she concluded, despite all this, you will die unhappy, and regret frequently the easy, pleasant life of Martinique. Young Rose would often joke about this prophecy to friends, and she often liked to tell the tale after becoming empress. The first part of the prophecy was true enough. Rose's marriage was arranged for her to a young vicomte, Alexandre de Beauharnais, who was 17 and who she had never met, as he was thousands of miles away in France. Originally, he had said that Rose sounded too close in age to him at 15, and instead requested one of her younger sisters. Rose herself, usually so easygoing and compliant, refused to be overlooked and flew into a tantrum with storms of protests and tears. She clung to her dream of going to France with a totally unexpected tenacity. Alexandre and his family relented, and Rose made the long voyage to France. Their first meeting was not a complete success. What Alexandra got was Rose. Provincial, adolescent, still cherubically plump, wearing no makeup, in her outdated clothes, and with an accent so thick that it could be cut with a knife. As Alexandra wrote in a carefully phrased letter to his father, "She may perhaps appear to you less pretty than you had expected, but I think I may assure you that her amiability and the sweetness of her nature will surpass even what you have been told of her." By contrast, Rose was bowled over by her fiancé. Alexandre was exactly the sort of young man that most girls of the time fantasized about. In an age where the most romantic of all professions was the army, he was a soldier, a young captain. Most impressive of all was Alexandre's manner. He was already impressively worldly, supremely confident and elegant, proud of his noble heritage and rich, with an income of 40,000 francs. Alexandre was also highly educated and said to be the best dancer in all of France, and even danced in Marie Antoinette's quadrilles. However, where women were concerned, he had no control. He was said to seduce for the sport of it, and to boast of it. Indeed, he had already been the lover of several aristocratic ladies, whose names and attributes he noted down in a secret list of conquests. From an island just as rustic and uncultivated as Napoleon's Corsica, fresh-faced Rose also found it difficult to settle into French life and to fit in. While Alexandra danced and debated and flirted, Rose was usually left at home, simply because he was embarrassed by her. In society, she seemed awkward and ignorant, and when shy Rose did mingle, it was clear that she had no witty turns of phrase, a provincial outlook, outdated ideas about politics, was naively idealistic about marriage and fidelity, and had no interest in intellectual pursuits. Rose was only too aware that she was not the sort of woman that her husband or Paris admired. Rose's lack of accomplishment caused friction in her marriage. Alexandra was determined that Rose had to become educated and accomplished. She read Alexandra's long and often patronizing letters on how to better herself, but simply refused to reciprocate in sending him replies. Perhaps she desisted through lack of confidence, as she would always be ashamed of her bad spelling and grammar, or in order to avoid Alexandra's lecturing. Maybe this was an early expression of Rose's strong instinct to avoid unpleasantness, or a forewarning of the skills she would later develop in passive power play. Rose refused to be moulded by her husband, and Alexandra, who once described his wife as an object who has nothing to say, in retaliation no longer stayed at home, but resumed his bachelor existence. As Rose recalled, Alexandra's taste for liberty and an inflexible will soon led him on to further adventures. While he complained, "She has become jealous and wants to know what I'm doing." A few years into the marriage, they had a son together, Eugène. But in their 4 years of married life, her husband had not spent more than 10 months with her. After a tour of Italy, and with little warning, the restless Alexandra was gone again. Despite Rose, now pregnant with a daughter, pleading with him not to leave her again so soon. This time, he was bound for the high seas of Martinique. Alexandra, egged on by his mistress, had by now decided to obtain a separation from his wife, so he sought to make a case against her, and began a witch hunt to gather incriminating evidence. Searching for scandal, Alexandra went to Rose's family's plantation and interrogated their slaves. In a society where to fail to say what a white man wanted to hear could lead to beatings or even death, it is a testament to the slaves' fondness for Rose that only one was induced to slander her. Alexandra offered money to a slave who had only been 5 when Rose had left Martinique to invent a series of unlikely allegations. Alexandra even accosted a female house slave. She was offered numerous incentives to reveal tales of Rose's supposed sexual transgressions, but to no avail. Alexandra was so enraged by this that he threatened to kill the poor woman if she revealed his conversation with her to anyone. Alexandra had been in Martinique for 6 months, and on the eve of his departure, he wrote Rose a staggering letter that would change the entire course of their lives. Alexandra then proceeded to itemize what he claimed to have been the then 16-year-old Rose's clandestine affairs, declaring that she was beneath all the in the world. Next, Alexandra claimed the newborn baby girl to be illegitimate. There was only one solution for this state of affairs. Have the decency to go to a convent as soon as you receive this letter. I expect that after this letter I shall not find you at my house, and I must warn you that you will find me a tyrant if you do not follow precisely what I have told you. As for Alexandra's elaborate charges of Rose's infidelity, no one could provide a single piece of evidence, and Rose's and Alexandra's own relatives rallied in her support. A few years later, Alexandra himself was brought to admit the baselessness of every single one of his charges, inspired, he conceded, by the passions and anger of youth. But he was determined that the breach with his wife would be decisive. At the tender age of 20, her marriage was irrevocably over. As time went on, Rose had no choice but to comply with Alexandra's wishes. She agreed to accept his demand that she enter a convent. In November 1783, Rose moved into a fashionable house of retreat at the convent of Pont-au-Mont. Entering a convent, only in a limited sense of the term, it did not mean that Rose was now condemned to a life of chastity, frugality, and piety. Since the Middle Ages, it had been an established custom for well-born French women, widows, spinsters, spurned wives, to rent lodgings in Parisian convents. Alexandra's decision to banish Rose to Juan was meant as a punishment, but it turned out to be an important turning point in her development. For the first time since she had arrived in France, she was surrounded by women like her, in similar circumstances. Here she first discovered, and then reinvented herself. Like an actress learning a part, Rose studied the sophisticated women who surrounded her to discover how to be une vraie Parisienne. Here is also where Rose first came into contact with the detailed rules of extramarital interaction in Paris. Rose began to understand that femininity was a performance. Rose came to understand how these women constructed their beauty, particularly in the capital, where natural prettiness held little charm. In Paris, a woman was like a diamond, according to Mercier, not beautiful till it has been cut and polished and set in its full brilliance. Rose naturally had some of the raw materials needed to become stylish in society, including a beautiful silvery voice, which would later lead Napoleon to say, "The first applause of the French people sounded to my ear as sweet as the voice of Josephine." She also had an empathetic nature and a bewitching way of moving, for which she would become so renowned. Her bearing was like one of the Caribbean Venuses of the island of her birth, who walked, remarked one observer, as if they were floating across sand, slowly and languorously, their heads held perfectly upright. She also picked up the habit of covering her mouth with a handkerchief whenever she laughed, to hide the bad teeth caused by her sugar-rich childhood diet, and which prompted her to develop her distinctive Mona Lisa smile, broad and beguiling, but with her teeth always covered. Rose has often been seen as a seductive, frivolous, extravagant coquette, but although not witty, she had perfected the art of conversation and knew very well what kind of attention successful men liked. Asked whether she had intelligence, the great wit Talleyrand was said to have replied, "No one ever managed so brilliantly without it." A woman who knew her well later was to observe that her attention wandered from any discussion of abstract ideas. Yet Rose was more than capable of feigning an interest in any subject, if she so desired, and knew well enough when to keep silent, rather than expose her ingenuity. Rose was also far from shallow culturally, having good taste in music and the decorative arts. Rose learned quickly through instinct and observation, through experience, conversation, and her adaptability, which was to help her throughout her life, allowed Rose to accomplish what all Alexandra's books could not, her transformation into a woman à la mode. It was during this time that the stylish, charming, graceful woman, who would eventually be renamed Josephine, began to emerge. After spending nearly a year at the convent, Rose moved just outside of Paris to the sleepy hamlet of Fontainebleau, near the famous palace. It was rumoured that she embarked upon an affair with the Duc de Lourdes, and also with the Chevalier de Coigny, who was 20 years older than her with a colourful past. And it was further supposed that her liaison with one or the other, if not both of these men, was the reason why she could now afford to purchase herself new dresses in the latest style. In the summer of 1788, Rose suddenly left for Martinique, taking her five-year-old daughter Hortense and reaching the island on the eve of the French Revolution. Rose settled into sedate island life, and her stay lasted for over 2 years. It is alleged that Rose found a lover among the officers in Martinique, Comte Scipion du Roi. Another naval officer wrote of Rose, "Without being exactly pretty, she was attractive because of her wit, gaiety, and good manners. She cared nothing for public opinion, and, as her funds were extremely limited, and she was most extravagant, she was often obliged to draw upon her admirers' pockets." Martinique first exposed Rose to the terrors of revolution. The violence that happened in France was felt overseas. By May 1790, the island of Martinique was electric with unrest. These troubles gave Rose a powerful impetus to leave Martinique. In the late summer of 1790, Rose happened to be in Fort Royal with Hortense, staying as guests of the governor. But then, the rebels who had seized the fort threatened the white population with immediate destruction. Terrified, Rose and Hortense quickly welcomed the invitation of the captain of a frigate and fled to the ship. Rose and Hortense had no time to even gather their luggage or to say goodbye to their family. As they crossed the public square known as the Savane, where Rose's statue once stood, until it was very recently destroyed in 2020, a cannon shot from the rebels in the fort kicked up the dust at their feet. In this way, Martinique bade a last farewell to its most famous name, as Rose never again returned to the island of her birth. Meanwhile, Alexandra, for a few dramatic months, shot upwards into a career of national prominence, holding the office of President of the Constituent Assembly, and then serving as Commanding General of the Army of the Rhine. But revolution, which so unexpectedly raised Alexandre to the heights, was also to bring him down. In early 1794, the blow fell, and Alexandre was denounced, arrested, and then taken to prison. Meanwhile, Rose worked hard to try to have him released, writing petitions and pleading with friends. Then, she received an anonymous letter, warning her that she was in danger too. Another woman might have fled, but as Rose wrote to her aunt, "Where could I go without compromising my husband?" In April, she was arrested, joining her husband at the old convent prison of Les Carmes. Gloomy and squalid, there was nothing to distract its prisoners from the imminence of death. The September massacres had taken place there a few years before, and the marks of sabres and ugly bloodstains could still be seen on the walls, ceilings and cobbles. Conditions there were vile, and women like Rose quickly learned to pick up the hems of their skirts to avoid the overflow of the latrine buckets. Dark and vermin-infested, the cells were cramped. Some of the women slept 14 in a room. But Rose and a few fellow female prisoners worked hard to keep their room clean. Rose was to spend more than 3 months here. All professions, all backgrounds, and all ages were condemned to live together as they awaited the guillotine. Cabinet makers, laundresses, and dentists slept alongside grand dames, generals, and deputies. Rose did not bear up well in prison, showing a degree of discouragement that was embarrassing to her companions. One of them wrote, "All the prisoners were resigned, but she continued hoping against hope." Rose spent those long days playing solitaire, anxiously trying to read her future in a pack of cards, and being prone to tears, weeping often, something which the more stoic women in the prison frowned on as bad form. However, according to Delphine de Custine, who Alexandre was now carrying on an affair with, despite her lack of courage, Rose was naturally gracious and had charming manners, being extremely seductive in her way of speaking. Her manner had inimitable charm, and in the prison she had conquered all hearts. Another close friend she made in prison was the Englishwoman Grace Elliot, the mistress of the Duke d'Orléans, and she was enraptured by Rose. She wrote in her diary, "She is one of the most accomplished and one of the most amiable women I have ever met." According to rumour, during these days of captivity, Rose was swept off her feet by the gallant figure of General Hoche, a fellow prisoner. He was awaiting his trial with his usual cheerful demeanour when he met Rose, and so he liked to claim they became lovers. Indeed, Hoche later divulged that while she was wonderful in bed, he was disgusted by what he termed her insatiable sexual appetite. Such an amour can be pardoned in prison, but hardly outside. One may take a prostitute for a mistress, but hardly for a wife. But their affair must have been remarkably short, as Hoche was soon transferred to another prison just 4 weeks after Rose had entered. Meanwhile, time had run out for Alexandre. In July, he appeared before the Revolutionary Tribunal and was found guilty. He was guillotined that same day and thrown into an unmarked grave. Rose learned of Alexandre's death when she found his name among the daily list of executions printed in the Paris newspaper and fainted from the shock. Rose seems to have anticipated her death. The jailers became even more ferocious. One morning, a prison guard entered the women's cell and took Rose's bed linen to give it to another prisoner. Her cellmate, the Duchess d'Aiguillon, challenged the guard, demanding to know whether it would be replaced with something better. "No," he replied with a smile, "she would not be needing it, since she would soon be on the way to the conciergerie and then onto the guillotine." Rose wavered between abject fear and resignation, and the hope that predestination would save her from death. In a strange and miraculous occurrence, Boussière, a minor actor hired by the Committee of Public Safety, had been removing the dossiers of certain favoured prisoners, so that through lack of documents, their trials would have to be postponed. He not only stole these selected dossiers, but he literally ate them. It has been claimed that he ate over 1,000 compromising documents and dossiers, and among them was Rose's. That night, Rose's bedsheets were brought back. On it she enjoyed, she said, "the soundest night's sleep of my life." She joked to her companions, "You see, I have not been guillotined, and I shall yet be crowned Queen of France." In the dying days of the Terror, when Rose came within a hair's breadth of the guillotine, she was saved by the dramatic workings of events. Sickened by the bloody excesses of the terror, and alarmed that they might be the next to be purged, a number of revolutionaries decided it was time to get rid of the seemingly all-powerful Robespierre. In July, Tallien received a dagger and a letter from his imprisoned mistress, the ravishingly beautiful Theresia Caribou. The message taunted him for lacking the courage to rescue her. "I die in despair at having belonged to a coward like you." Motivated by shame and love, Tallien led the attack the next day. Brandishing his lover's dagger, he interrupted Robespierre's speech to the convention with the repeated cry, "Down with the tyrant! Down with the dictator!" Emboldened by this, the deputies turned on Robespierre, demanding his arrest. Finally, in August, an official order signed by Tallien declared that Rose was to be released from prison. Rose fainted on hearing the news. Once free, Rose was soon again deep in debt and was borrowing money from anyone who would lend it to her. It was not a time to be short of money in Paris. A new age was dawning for France. To the reign of terror succeeded the reign of women, again emancipated. The women of this new age, called les merveilleuses, the marvelous ones, paraded everywhere. Fashionable women discarded their corsets and adopted classic diadems, cameos, and clinging sleeveless gauze-like dresses. This clothing underwent increasingly daring modifications. However, even in Paris, it was possible to overdo or underdo it, as when Rose's friend, a fellow Creole, Madame Orlan, agreed in a dare to walk from the Luxembourg Palace to the Champs-Élysées in a dress that left her naked to the waist, she was followed by a jeering mob. Though a little more conservative than some of her friends, Rose suited this Grecian style of dress, reminiscent of the Creole shifts of her youth. Her preference was for white dresses made of muslin fabric so fine that it had to be woven underwater. She was draped, not dressed, and the effect was voluptuous and sculptural. But Rose was pretty without being beautiful, and in a city like Paris, would never have gotten far by her looks alone. Frénilly, who knew her in 1795, while conceding her kindness and charm, described her as one of those women who are able to stay for 15 years at the age of 30. But she possessed two other qualities. She was spirited and she was kind. Her even temper, her easygoing disposition, the kindness that filled her eyes, and was expressed not only in her words, but in the very tone of her voice. All this gave her a charm that counterbalanced the dazzling beauty of her two rivals, Madame Tallien and Madame Récamier. Her goodness and willingness to help those in need won her many hearts, friends, and connections. The small incidents of her life, she constantly found amusing, droll, one of her favourite words. But she was also a woman of moods, who seemed incapable of being consistent. Above all, Rose was a consummate people-pleaser, capable of navigating turbulent times without offending anyone. As Rose herself put it, she was too indolent to take sides, and could sustain people's affections in the most difficult of circumstances. Rose's best friend, and the leader of this new society, was Madame Theresia Tallien. Dubbed the sorry queen of a motley court, Madame Tallien was an extraordinary beauty, and became a symbol of freedom recovered, so much so that she and her husband provoked hysteria whenever they went out together, and she was called Our Lady of Thermidor. Despite an age gap of 10 years, Rose and Theresia quickly became close friends, and became, in some sense, the twin rulers of this bizarre society. Theresia was very well connected in government circles. Indeed, wits of the time dubbed her government property. One of the directors, Paul Barat, would take her as his mistress for a time. She then turned from him to the rich banker, Ouvrard. De Goncourt pointed out that the women of this period passed from one husband to another, unbinding and refastening her girdle. As the fancy seized her, they marry and divorce, destroy marriage to marry again. Amid this moral spectacle, Rose had to find her way. Her problem, starkly simple, was survival. She was a woman in a man's world. Even if there had been an opportunity for employment, as an aristocratic woman, she had been prepared for no other occupation than marriage. Mature, sophisticated, and surely a woman of few illusions, she now entered the delicate world of political and financial liaisons. In this society, Rose managed to flourish, borrowing money whenever she could, cultivating new and influential friends, and taking care to keep old friendships in good repair. Now Rose lived alone, and she lived for fun. She blotted out those terrible months in the shadow of the guillotine, with parties and the frou-frou of pretty clothes, and enjoyed intimate relations with men and their spending money. Thanks to her influential contacts, profitable business deals were put her way. She soon had enough money to give the impression that she lived a very affluent lifestyle, and she exuded an elegance and unattainability which attracted the attention of many men. Someone who was a good judge of character, however, might have sensed that beneath the grace and kindness, the negligent poses and nonchalant movements, was a woman of quiet desperation, with a ferocious striving for security and a frantic need for pleasure. It was now, in the hedonistic days of 1795, that Barras first introduced a new face into his social circle, a man described as Barras's Italian protégé, and now the much-talked-about General Vendémiaire, the saviour of the revolution, the 26-year-old Napoleon Bonaparte. During the early days of their acquaintance at a party at the Italian's cottage, Rose persuaded Napoleon to tell fortunes. Among the guests was General Hoche, who had been in prison with Rose where, according to rumour, they had an affair. Tall and muscular, with a duelling scar like a comma between his brows, Hoche looked every inch the soldier. Napoleon, who did not look like a soldier at all, and was becoming fond of Rose, may have felt a little jealous. Napoleon playfully went around the other guests, taking the hand of each and predicting an agreeable future, inventing a thousand follies. But when he came to Hoche, his mood darkened. He took Hoche's hand, inspected the lines on it, and announced curtly, "General, you will die in your bed." Hoche treated the prediction as an insult, as indeed it was, implying cowardice on the battlefield. He flushed angrily and scowled at Napoleon. Quickly and tactfully, Rose intervened. "Nothing bad about that," she said. "Alexander the Great died in his bed," and the little tiff passed off. Josephine's 12-year-old daughter, Hortense, remembered when she first met Napoleon at a dinner held by Barras at the Luxembourg. "I found myself placed in between my mother and a general, who, in order to talk to her, kept leaning forward so often and with so much vivacity that he wearied me and obliged me to lean back. Thus, in spite of myself, I looked attentively upon his face, which was handsome and very expressive, but remarkably pale. He spoke with fire in his voice and seemed to devote all his attention to my mother. It was General Bonaparte." Hortense also noticed that every time she returned home from her boarding school, the general's attention to her mother had become more assiduous. Napoleon began to fall desperately in love, but as he did so, he tried to draw back. Perhaps he thought of his staid and thrifty mother, who would certainly not approve of this lively older widow, who already had two children and expensive tastes. He also probably heard the rumours that were circulating about Josephine at the time. Among the other visitors to her house was Paul Barras, one of the most powerful men in France. During this time, food was being rationed, and Barras used to send Josephine baskets stacked with poultry, game, and expensive fruit. On days when Barras was giving a party at his house, Josephine would go there to act as hostess, but no woman could be friends with Barras and keep her name unspoiled. At 40, Barras was an attractive man, tall and strong, with a sarcastic mouth, piercing green eyes, and an easy manner. As well as being a brilliant politician, Barras was also a decadent roué, a cynical profiteer, excessive, crooked, and treacherous. As one foreign diplomat remarked, he would throw the Republic out of the window tomorrow if it did not pay for his dogs, his horses, his mistresses, his table, and his gambling. Another politician remarked, "Barras had all the vices of a king without having a single one of the virtues." With a wife tucked away somewhere in the south of France, Barras offered none of his partners marriage or fidelity, but he did provide them with witty company, his patronage, and financial support. It is generally accepted that Madame Tallien was one of Barras's mistresses, and he himself claimed that Josephine was another. Whatever his dissipated qualities, and however transient their relationship and the nature of it, Barras gave Josephine a prominent place in the strange, vicious society of the Directory. Hearing these rumours, Napoleon began to keep away from Josephine's house. Instead, he concentrated on his military duties and keeping order in Paris. No easy task. This was at a time when France was in the grip of a vicious inflation, while some Frenchmen fed well and many others starved. Fortunes were made and then recklessly squandered by war profiteers, contractors, and the speculators who had flourished in these years of crisis. In the winter of 1794, when the River Seine froze over, while some gorged themselves at magnificent banquets, many people begged, starved and shivered in the streets. People could be seen chopping up their beds for firewood to cook what little food they could find, and queuing endlessly to buy the rationed loaves of so-called bread, a soggy concoction of sawdust, chestnuts and beans, the same bread which, according to a popular anecdote, was so cloggy and unappetizing that when the Baron de Frénilly once threw a handful of it to his dog, it stuck to the wall, and the dog refused to eat it. But it is impossible to die of hunger with more gaiety, Frénilly acknowledged. In his new post, Napoleon immediately reorganized the National Guard, and efficient order was slowly re-established. Napoleon was mostly busy visiting the different arrondissements of Paris, going to the poverty-stricken garrets and cellars, and ordering firewood and bread to be distributed to the poor. One day, would-be bread rioters, mostly women, surrounded a squadron that Napoleon was commanding. As the crowd closed in on them, and the outcries for bread increased, Napoleon and his officers seemed to be in a critical situation. One plump woman was shouting especially violently, and was trying to work up the crowd. "What do these soldiers care if us poor folk starve to death?" she shouted, "provided that they fill their own skins." To which Napoleon, who was then to use his own phrase, but a slip of parchment, retorted, "My good woman, look at me, and say which of us has fed the best." The contrast in their profiles was too comical. The woman was completely taken aback, and the crowd's tension dissolved into gales of laughter, who dispersed in good humour. One day, when stepping down from his carriage to dine at Madame Pomont's house, a woman, holding her dead baby in her arms, approached him. Sheer hunger had made her unable to produce milk, and her unweaned baby had died of starvation. Her husband was dead, and her five children were crying for food at home. "If I cannot obtain relief," the mother cried, "I must take my remaining five children and drown myself with them." Napoleon questioned her, asked where she lived, and after giving her some money to meet her immediate needs, entered the Pomont house, sitting down with the other guests to the lavish dinner being held. But Napoleon was deeply affected by the wretchedness he had just seen, and the other guests were struck by his absent manner and his sad expression. Napoleon made inquiries about the poor woman, and finding all she had said verified, took the family under his protection, gaining employment for her daughters in needlework among his friends. According to the Duchess d'Abmonté, more than 100 families were saved from starvation by his personal efforts. Napoleon was so busy with his new position that social visits were not easily managed, and his connection with the widow Beauharnais was almost in danger of lapsing. It was Josephine who saved the day. She began to miss Napoleon's visits. She had become interested in this mysterious young general who did not look like a soldier, and whose life had been as adventurous as her own. A fashionable painter had recently praised Napoleon's features, describing them as classical and Grecian, and perhaps this made her see his gaunt cheeks in a better light. She sent him a little note. "You no longer come to see a friend who is fond of you. You have completely forsaken her. You are wrong, for she is tenderly attached to you. Come tomorrow, Saturday, to lunch with me. I need to see you and talk to you about your affairs. Good night, mon ami. I embrace you." Napoleon could not reply fast enough. In a note sent the same evening, he wrote, "I cannot imagine the reason for the tone of your letter. I beg you to believe that no one desires your friendship as much as I do. No one could be more eager to prove it. Had my duties permitted, I would have come in person to deliver this message." This was the simple beginning of what, soon enough, exploded into an ardent affair. From the next day onwards, Napoleon resumed his visits to Josephine and spent nearly every evening at her soirées. He was strange, he was different, and he had eyes only for her. Josephine's moral standards could be summed up in the phrase, "I must look after my children and be kind," otherwise she lived for the day, and Napoleon was pressing. One evening in January 1796, Josephine invited Napoleon to her little house at Rue Chantereine, presumably to dine with her. Determined to give the illusion that she was wealthy, Josephine had 8 servants, and filled the house with flowers to hide the fact that she had few paintings and little furniture. But Napoleon saw only a charming and elegant woman to inspire admiration and desire. In this atmosphere of refined luxury, Napoleon and Josephine made love for the first time. For her, it was doubtless a diversion, something droll, but for Napoleon, this was the first time he had possessed a woman he loved, and into the experience went all the force of a very passionate nature, which had been kept in check since adolescence. Next day, Napoleon wrote her the first of many love letters, expressing some of his feelings. I awake full of you, your image, and the memory of last night's intoxicating pleasures. Allow my senses no rest. Sweet and incomparable Josephine, what a strange effect you have upon my heart. Are you angry? Do I see you sad? Are you worried? Then my soul cries out with grief, and there is no rest for your lover. But how much the more when I yield to this passion that masters my inmost self, when I draw from your lips and from your heart a flame that burns me? Ah, yes, that night has taught me well how far your portrait falls short of yourself. You leave at midday. In 3 hours I shall see you again. Until then, 1,000 kisses, mia dolce amor. But give me none in return, for they set my blood on fire. As for Josephine, she took it all in her stride. In her circle, it was considered poor taste or a bad joke to treat bed as more than a passing pleasure. It spoiled the fun. Regular physical relations with a woman had not seemed to have fallen within Napoleon's experience until now. Josephine was a seasoned voluptuary, and Napoleon was unsurprisingly swiftly enraptured. All of his conceptual ideas about love as just a social feeling and dismissive remarks about the French, entirely absorbed by eroticism, were shattered. Napoleon was probably quite impressed with her charms, later disclosing that she did something in bed which he called zigzags. Josephine was hardly a paragon of virtue, but this Napoleon did not fully realise or experience the drawbacks of until much later on. Unlike Desiree Clary, who had fulsomely adored and looked up to him, Josephine represented a challenge. This attracted a man like Napoleon, who was drawn to difficulty and risk, and for whom pleasure and danger never seemed to be far apart. Older, elusive, capricious, luxury-loving, she was the sort of female sensualist that he could not resist trying to conquer. As one of his biographers put it, the artificial woman, the coquette whose only preoccupation is to subjugate the stronger sex, appeared to him like an enemy whom he wished to make capitulate. Josephine had given herself to him, as she had to others before him, in liaisons that could be terminated at any time. So when Napoleon began to question her about Barras, it was perhaps in order to cool his ardour that she told him the rumours were true, that she had been Barras's mistress, though she was no longer. This did not seem to deter Napoleon. He could have easily left it at that, and kept a woman like Josephine as his mistress. Morals were relaxed during this revolutionary period, but Napoleon liked everything regular and orderly, romantically and sexually outgunned. Napoleon quickly proposed to her. But at this point, Josephine was more intrigued by Napoleon than in love with him. She did admit that she found this young general who had far too much intensity, who spoke his mind in such a decided way, and had given her a new name, oddly attractive. As she wrote to a friend, I admire the general's courage, the extent of his knowledge, for on all subjects he speaks equally well, and the quickness of his judgment, which enables him to seize the thoughts of others almost before they are expressed. His searching gaze has something singular about it which fascinates me, which imposes even upon our directors. Judge if it may not intimidate a woman. But he had not yet won her heart. He was silent and awkward with other women, yet passionate and lively with her, altogether strange in all his person. What was later to be identified as genius was now only eccentricity. Napoleon was underestimated by many as an outsider, a provincial dishevelled coxcomb who had become the flavour of the month, but who lacked the required social graces to make much headway in high society. Speaking of the directory, Napoleon said to Josephine, Think they, then, that I have need of their protection to arrive at power? Egregious mistake. They will all be only too happy one day, should I condescend to grant them mine. My sword is by my side, and with it I will go far. Josephine confided to a friend, What say you to this security of success? Is it not a proof of confidence, springing from an excess of vanity, a general of brigade to protect the heads of government? That truly is an event highly probable. I know not how it is, but sometimes this waywardness gains upon me to such a degree that almost I believe possible whatever this singular man may take into his head to attempt. And with his imagination, who can calculate what he will not undertake? Despite his undoubted potential, his future was far from secure, as hers might well be too if she decided to marry him. On the other hand, this dark and fathomable soldier certainly differed from the Talians, the Barras, and the Uvards, whom Josephine had come to know. Perhaps Napoleon did not make her expensive gifts, but he had a sincerity that Barras lacked. To a woman like Josephine, his ardour and constant craving for her presence was most flattering, while she did not have to worry about divided loyalties, wives, or competition of any kind. Napoleon was too honest and upfront to play games. What she liked less was, paradoxically, his fire, which disquieted her, the fact that he was demanding, and the fact that she would have to belong to him alone, after a decade of being a single woman. Maybe she wondered if Napoleon, who had read the doomed love story of the sorrows of young Werther several times in his youth, was enjoying playing the role of fervent lover a little too much. His all-consuming passion worried her. She was unable to match it. Besides, any fire can cool quickly, so their courtship continued, and Josephine made Napoleon wait for an answer through the winter. Years later, Josephine recalled that she had had inner struggles and long reluctance before she accepted Napoleon's proposal. Josephine weighed up her feelings in another letter to a friend.
You are going to ask, do you love him? Not exactly. Do you feel aversion to him? No. But I find myself in that state of indifference which is anything but agreeable, and which religious people find the most tiresome state of all. Love, being a species of worship, also requires that one feel very differently from all this.
To make a decision has always appeared tiring to my Creole supineness, which finds it infinitely more convenient to follow the will of others. Tiresome also was the fact that Josephine was now 32 years old, and with no sure income. She wanted a husband by her side, someone to protect and support her, while her two children were in need of the guiding hand of a father. Although Napoleon had no savings or property, she was aware that he had enough money to pay off her old debts, and enough credit to allow her to incur fresh ones. Although she was not a mercenary woman, Josephine needed money. She was a born spendthrift, and when she had cash, she scattered it freely. She was generous and spent on others as much as herself, but wherever she went, debts rose around her like a rampart. In the end, the combination of the young general's startling success and prospects, the fact that unlike her first husband, he seemed infatuated with her, his genuine affection for her children, and the approval of Barras, as well as her own increasing age and diminishing prospects, and Napoleon's persistence, made Josephine relent. It is remarkable how quickly Napoleon was able to swoon the none-too-eager Josephine into marriage. They had only been seeing each other regularly for 100 days before their wedding. However, in these revolutionary times, the marriage would only be a civil union, a mere partnership, which could be formed or dissolved at pleasure. The one person who Napoleon consulted about the marriage was poor Barras. Napoleon had previously asked him for the command of the army of Italy, but Barras's first instinct had been to say no. As Barras was in control of the interior, and Napoleon was doing a good job there, it was against his interest to transfer him. Besides, there were older generals with better claims to it. But then, Barras learned that Napoleon was thinking of marrying Josephine, and his request appeared to him in a new light. Barras had only just come to power and felt insecure. Of the five directors, he was the only one of noble birth, and he felt the need of friends of the same class. Napoleon and Josephine were both ex-nobles, but Napoleon was still an outsider, a Corsican, former friend of the traitor Paoli, and not yet wholly accepted. By marrying Josephine, Napoleon would remove any remaining doubts about his political loyalty. In them, Barras hoped to have two useful allies. So Barras encouraged Napoleon to marry his alleged former mistress, from whom, incidentally, he wished to become disentangled. In recommending the marriage, Barras said, "You have rank, the talent to become a hero, but you are isolated, without fortune, without relations. It would be best of you to marry. That will give you confidence. She belongs both to the old regime and to the new. She will give you stability, and she is the best salon in Paris." But not only did Barras approve of the marriage, he now reconsidered Napoleon's request. If Napoleon acquired stability, it would be in his advantage to appoint him to the army of Italy. Any successes in that post would reflect credit on him. To cap it all off, Barras let it be known to Napoleon and Josephine that if they did get married, his wedding present to them would be the army of Italy. Napoleon had already wanted to marry Josephine anyway, and Barras' offer was merely an added incentive, but at first, Josephine did not see it like that. She was upset by this mingling of love and politics. There was the inevitable lover's quarrel. One evening in February, Josephine made the first of many dreadful scenes. She accused Napoleon of wanting to marry her only in order to get the command in Italy. Napoleon profusely denied the charge. How, he asked her, with tears in his eyes, could she have entertained so base a feeling? Later, when Napoleon returned to his house, he wrote Josephine a letter. But instead of retaliating, he found, doubtless to his own surprise, that he returned to lay his heart at her feet. So you thought that I did not love you for yourself. For what then? Oh, madame, did you really think this? Could so base a feeling have been conceived by such a pure spirit? I am still astonished at it, but less, however, than at the feeling which on my awakening brings me back to your feet, without resentment and without willpower. It is impossible to be weaker or to be brought lower.
What is your strange power, incomparable Josephine?
One of your thoughts poisons my life, tears my soul apart. But a stronger feeling, a less sensitive mood, takes hold of me, draws me back, and rules me again as if I were guilty. I truly feel that if we quarrel I should close my heart. And you, mia dolce amor, have you spared me even two thoughts? I kiss you three times. Once on your heart, once on your lips, and once over your eyes. After they'd made up, Josephine took Napoleon to see her notary, Ragadeau. The notary took Josephine into his office, but inadvertently, he failed to shut the door properly, and Napoleon, waiting outside, could hear everything that was said. After Josephine had explained her intentions, Ragadeau flatly suggested,
"Why not marry an army contractor who can give you all the money you need? Far more sensible to marry a statesman like Barras, or a financier," he added. "This is a very great mistake, and you're going to be sorry for it. You're doing something quite mad, marrying a man who has only his army cloak and sword. Why, he lives in a den or a hovel, doesn't he? A little bit of a general without a name or a future, under the feet of all the generals in the Republic."
Napoleon did not say a word to Josephine about what he had overheard, and his only comment was to say that Ragadeau seemed to be an honest and shrewd lawyer, and that she should entrust her affairs to him. But his words left a lasting sting, and Napoleon clearly never forgot them. His only revenge, perhaps the greatest example of getting even in history, would take place 8 years later. On the morning of his coronation as Emperor of the French, Napoleon, in his majestic robes, summoned the bewildered old man to the Tuileries, turned to him, and asked, "What do you think of my cloak and sword now?" He then gave him a ticket for a good seat in Notre Dame Cathedral, so that he could see for himself how far the little bit of a general without a future had brought his client on her way. In the meantime, Ragadeau drew up a marriage contract quite unfavourable to Napoleon. There was to be no community of goods. Josephine's contribution was nothing at all, and Napoleon was to pay his wife 1,500 livres a year for life. Napoleon's declaration of his assets was simple. He owned, he said, neither real nor personal estate, and indeed possessed nothing except his wardrobe and his military accoutrements, which he was not willing to state the value of. Josephine had no property in France, and did not even own her house at Rue Chantereen. She might be very rich from her family's plantation one day, but for the moment she was virtually penniless. And by marrying her, Napoleon was also making himself responsible for her two children, both attending expensive boarding schools, at a time when he was already supporting two brothers and three sisters on his general's pay. Yet, Napoleon was so in love with her that having made these calculations, he decided that it did not matter. Somehow he'll be able to manage. Moreover, knowing that they would disapprove, for many reasons, Napoleon did not tell one member of his family that he was going to marry Josephine. They found out afterwards. At 8 p.m. on the 9th of March 1796, a group of important persons gathered to witness Napoleon and Josephine's wedding at the once glamorous Hôtel de Mondragon. The reception room where this ceremony was performed preserved its ostentatious decoration from the beginning of the 18th century, doors, shutters, mirror frames, with their borders of wreaths and roses, garlands and old gold. But as Josephine recalled, the room looked like faded grandeur, was crudely furnished, and was lit by a single half-hearted candle flickering in a tin sconce. Barras was there, wearing his flamboyant triple-plume velvet hat, as was Monsieur Tallien, to whose courage Josephine owed her life. Josephine herself arrived early, and wore a high-waisted muslin dress, decorated with patriotic red, white, and blue flowers. Only one person was missing. There was no sign of the groom. There was nowhere comfortable to sit, and as they waited for Napoleon to arrive, emotion must have been on the edge. The clock ticked, and the minutes dragged on into hours. Whenever Josephine spoke of that night, she remembered watching the single candle in the room burn down to nothing in the wait. The official who was meant to marry them finally grew tired of waiting and went to bed, leaving the ceremony to an underling, who hobbled about on his wooden leg. At long last, 2 hours late at 10 p.m, the clatter of footsteps was heard on the marble staircase, the door was thrown open, and the newly appointed commander of the Army of Italy rushed in. If any of them had known Napoleon well enough, none of this would have been a great surprise. Carried away with his plans for the Italian campaign, Napoleon had become so engrossed in his maps, books, and statistical tables that he completely lost track of time. No matter how great and all-encompassing his love for Josephine, it would always come second to his duty. The registrar, an ex-soldier with a wooden leg, had dozed off beside the fire. Scarcely waiting to greet his guests, Napoleon strode over to him and shook him awake by the shoulder.
Come on, Monsieur le Maire.
Marry us, quickly. The ceremony was over and done within a few minutes. There was no reception or wedding supper, and the witnesses either returned home or went for a drink together. Despite their bizarre wedding, one of the greatest love stories in history had begun. In the embrace of this languorous Creole, Napoleon's passion would sweep them both into the orbit of classical romance. Along with a ring, as a wedding present, Napoleon gave Josephine a simple necklace of fine gold, inscribed with two simple but poignant words, "To Destiny." The newly married Napoleon and Josephine drove through the cold March night in a carriage pulled by two black horses to the pretty, unpaid-for house in Rue Chantereine. But Napoleon found he was not to be alone with his new bride on their wedding night. Josephine had a pug called Fortune, who was devoted to her, and during her imprisonment in the days of the Terror, the little dog had carried smuggled letters in his collar between her and her children, and from then on she would never be parted from him, leading Napoleon to once joke to a friend, "You see that fellow there? He is my rival." The spoiled dog had the privilege of sleeping on Josephine's bed. When Napoleon tried to claim the same right, Fortune resented it. "I wished to make him get off it. Vain hope. I was told frankly that I must resign myself to sleep elsewhere, or consent to share the bed with him. Not a very pleasing alternative." "That was sufficiently exasperating, but take it or leave it, I was told, and I resigned myself to it." The darling creature was by far less accommodating than I was. The ill-tempered canine barked, snapped, and bit his human love rival on the calf. Josephine, who had been left to cool her heels at the altar for nearly 2 hours, might have felt that it served him right. The day after the wedding, the newlyweds went to visit Josephine's children, Eugène and Hortense, at their school. Josephine, displaying an unusual lack of nerve, had begged the headmistress, Madame Compin, to break the news of the marriage to her children for her. But despite her efforts, the bride and groom found Eugène reserved, and Hortense weeping because she thought that her new stepfather, who was a general after all, was bound to be very strict. On the contrary, Napoleon was fond of children in general, and of Josephine's children in particular. He went out of his way to please the blue-eyed Hortense. He exercised all his charm to try to win them over, doing whatever he could to make them feel comfortable with him, visiting their classrooms and strolling through the gardens with them. Napoleon even melted the austere manner of Madame Compin, and he arranged to have his virtually literate sister Caroline enrolled at this school, and for his youngest brother Jerome to join Eugène at his school. Napoleon only slightly undermined his efforts at the very end of the visit, when, as was his habit when he was pleased with someone, he gave Hortense one of his affectionate, though infamously strong, pinches on the ear, almost bringing her to tears again. But by the end of the visit, Josephine's children knew that they had a new father that they could learn to trust and love. That night, Napoleon immersed himself in old military books, all focused on the region where he was going to fight. These dry tones were not exactly the stuff of which a honeymoon is made, but when Josephine tried to lure him away from them, "Patience, my dear, we'll have time to make love when the war is won." The soldier's honeymoon lasted only 2 days and two nights. Perhaps Napoleon was leaving too much to fate when he said that lovemaking could wait. Without Napoleon's knowledge, the Directory had already decided to withhold Josephine's passport to travel to Italy. They did not want their young hero distracted from his military duties by his wife's charms. Barras had been boasting when he said that he could simply give Napoleon command of the army of Italy. First, he had to get the consent of a fellow director, General Carnot. He examined Napoleon's campaign plan, in which he proposed to strike through northern Italy and sign peace under the walls of Vienna. This plan had been criticized by General Berthier already, who said it would demand 50,000 extra troops, and by General Schurer, the former commander in Italy, who had been dismissed due to excessive drinking, and who called it the work of a madman, such as could only be executed by a madman. Carnot, however, thought well of the plan. He and Barras drafted the order transferring Napoleon to the command of the army of Italy. Carnot explained, "We can place you in the command of men alone, for the troops are destitute of everything, and we can give you no money to provide supplies. Give me only men enough," Napoleon replied, "and I ask for nothing more. I will be answerable for the result." He was only 26 years old. "You are rather young," one of the directors said, "to assume responsibility so weighty, and to take the command over veteran generals." "In 1 year," Napoleon retorted, I shall be either old or dead. On the evening of the 11th of March, a carriage drew up outside the house where his happiness had been so brief. Napoleon wrapped Josephine in his arms, kissed her goodbye, and promised to see her again soon. Then, in a light, fast carriage, he took the road south to his new command. With him went Junot and Chauvet, and his 17-year-old brother Louis, who was to be trained as his aide-de-camp, a promise of reinforcements made by the directors, and the portrait, seldom long from his lips, of his incomparable Josephine.